How would you describe this budget, Mr. Senate President?
I believe it's probably one of the best budgets that we've encountered in recent years. It's actually tuning into a lot of social services, adding budgets to a lot of social services of government. As mentioned earlier by Senator Sonny Angara and Congressman Zahdi Ko, we increased the budgets of assistance to individuals in crisis situations for the DSWD. That's a social fund for the DSWD. We increased a social fund as well in the DOLE, which is the TUPAD, which is the employment fund for emergency employment fund for the DOLE. We've increased budgets for hospital construction, including the specialty centers. We passed a law recently, which was the promise of the president, to increase specialty hospitals for heart conditions, liver, lung, and cancer treatment centers all over the country. So even state universities and colleges, we increased their budgets by several billions of pesos. As mentioned, even UP and the other state universities and colleges all over the country. It's great to note in the last bar examination that several schools outside of Metro Manila, which are state universities, also got to be part of the top 20 in terms of the bar examinations. That's great to hear that we're spreading out educational programs and all across the country. And of course, performance of these SUCs increase with additional budgets that we give them. But I would like to make special mention, Karen, of the move of the Senate. This is a Senate initiative of promising our armed services several months ago, because of the actions that are happening in the West Philippine Sea, that we have to put our money where our mouth is as well as legislators and help fund our armed services. And I'm happy to announce that we, the Senate, through my initiative and the initiative of Senator Sonny Angara and our senators, we're able to add about 10.471 million to be exact, on these particular budgets for the DND, as well as the Coast Guard, the National Intelligence Coordinating Agency, the BIFAR, together with the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. If I may, to just in a nutshell, I don't want to telegraph our punches on national television, particularly those who are listening that are not very friendly to Philippine interests. But we had added about 6.1 billion to the Department of National Defense budget for protection of our skies, of our sea lanes. When I say protection, these are weapon systems. We got a budget for weapon systems that will protect our skies, will protect our sea lanes, and of course, our armed services within the Philippine territory. I'd rather not give it in detail, but yeah. We also have a budget for the Philippine Coast Guard. Karen, remember when Commodore J. Tariela was complaining, yes, that they had, yeah, such a small budget? Well, we, yeah, added 2.8 billion to their budget. I think that was the biggest single increase in their budget ever. And with this 2.8 billion, 2.5 billion will be for three ships. We're going to give them three very large ships, as that's a down payment. And the good news, Karen, is we're already discussing a company that builds ships for Australian Navy, which is Austal, and we want to build it, and we got the approval of the president. We want to build it in Cebu, in Balanban. So these ships will be Philippine-made. Of course, it's Australian-owned company, but Philippine-made by the hands of Filipinos in the Philippines. And we're looking at, they promised to try to bring down the delivery to 18 months. And I think this is what's going to happen now. We just passed also yesterday, Karen, on third reading in the Senate, the SRDP, which is the Self-Reliance Defense Posture Program, which will now allow DND and the AFP and all the other agencies of government, like the PNP, to purchase defense equipment that are locally manufactured. So we're going to push jumpstart the local production of all this military equipment in country. So it can be a foreign owned company coming to the Philippines, setting up shop in one of our PEZA zones, building armored personnel carriers, even aircraft. And the ships are going to be done in Cebu and Cavite for fast patrol crafts. So not only will it help protect our country, Karen, but it's going to also open up tens of thousands of jobs. The three ships, at least 2.5 billion peso budget for three Coast Guard ships, they're looking at employing 3,000 employees in Balamban, Cebu, in their shipyard there, for just for these three ships alone. So imagine if we do that and replicate that all over the country.
Okay, no, that is good news. It's definitely good news, at least. It's a big jump for the Philippine Coast Guard. I'll go to other parts of the budget before we go back to the West Philippine Sea issue. You have opposition lawmakers, and I think it's interesting that have pointed out wins, some flaws, small victories in the budget. But I wanted to ask you first, let's talk about education. How much was the increase in the education budget? Congresswoman Franz Castro said that with a classroom shortage, problems in class size, 100 million pesos only was put in for basic education facilities in terms of the addition, and 6.5 million for the improvement and acquisition of school sites. So she called this a band-aid solution. You may not have the details in front of you, but you say it's fair that the addition to the education budget is, she describes it as measly.
Well, I was about to sweat in my seat because you're going to ask me details of the budget that Senator Sandy Agarra would probably know more about.
On a general view,
Definitely we should put more budget in education. If you've seen the PISA results that came out the other day, we were bottom of the list. It's very obvious and clear that education is still a problematic area of our plan to graduate into middle income economy and get more investments all over the world here. Obviously, if you do not have an educated population, it's going to be difficult for locators from all around the world to invest into our country. So we're looking into that deeply. That's why we increased the budgets of our SUCs. We increased the budgets of our educational institutions. We, of course, increased the budget as well of the DepEd, but not as much as what we would really like to see and what we really want to. So in a way, I don't know the exact figure, but of course, it's never enough, Karen. No, it's never enough. There's not enough funds to repair schools. We still get constantly bombarded by mayors who go to our offices and ask us for classroom buildings. It's not enough. Kulang na kulang talaga. So we should also look into that long-term solutions. And maybe if we do more revenue increasing measures, I think it should be earmarked for education. If you ask me, if we come up with more revenue measures, we should put a certain amount that will be solely focused on education, their education advocacy or system of government. And doing that, we'll be able to focus on classroom construction, teachers training, because garbage in is garbage out, Karen. So we really have to focus on teachers training of our teachers, making them more globally world-class. No, and I think that's what we need to do.
Okay. Now, when it comes to confidential funds, so this Congress really took a strong stand, right? Yes. In actually making sure that certain civilian agencies no longer got secret funds. But I wanted to ask you this, Representative Castro, I'm not sure if you're aware of this particular provision, but most likely you're aware of this one, is there's a special provision in the budget for contingent funds, which allows the issuance of confidential and intelligence funds to departments and agencies not concerned with security if the president certifies as to the extreme necessity. So kumbaga, even if Congress has taken a stand on removing confidential funds, she is alarmed with that provision that the president can still align if he says it's a necessity. I can move this to the vice president's office. I can move this there. Is that correct? Is that the right understanding?
I think the best person to ask about that is Senator Sonny Angara, chairman of finance. But I think I just want to just weigh into the issue by saying, I think this has been done all throughout other budgets. It's only now this budget talaga nakatutok tayo sa CIF, Confidential Intelligence Funds. Pero dung araw, Karen, in the past, I believe that that has always been a possibility within the budget of utilizing contingent funds to help additional, to help government agencies that lack funding for certain programs and projects. The president had always that leeway to be able to augment the funds that way. So it's nothing new in the budgeting process. That was told to me once by Sonny, Senator Sonny, but I guess to get the details from him would be the best. And we just, you're absolutely correct. This Congress, we made a stand, and very little, if not nil, no, there's zero CIF given to these civilian agencies. And I think, you know, if they do ask for intelligence funds, confidential intelligence funds, it's their call. These civilian agencies have to explain to the public. I mean, we are now online real time. You know, they're going to have to explain to the public why they needed confidential intelligence funds, that they were not able to utilize their own line item budget for this particular reason. I'll give you an example.
Okay,
go ahead. I know for a fact that DICT wanted intelligence funds.
Yes.
To the last minute, Secretary Uri was insistent that he needed intelligence funds. But the sponsor in the Senate, Senator Grace Poe, said, no, because we can put it in your line item. What do you need? You need equipment to run after hackers. So they put in a new line item that says purchasing of equipment for anti-hacking and anti-espionage, whatever. So it's there in the budget.
I get it.
So linagay na namin dun. So to address the needs of the Department of DICT. And more, it's now more transparent, Karen. Mm-hmm. So you see the funds, you see the amount in the line item, and now you can monitor how it was spent, how it was bidded out, how it was purchased. I think that's the best thing we have done in this budget, is making it more transparent.
Okay. Now, being a Mindanaoan, the recent bombing in Marawi, I mean, of course, that was a tragedy. You issued a statement there. But it also shed to light the fact that that's where intelligence funds should be used. If intelligence funds were used, then they would have intel and information that a bombing was being planned, right? It wouldn't catch MSU by surprise or Marawi by surprise. When it comes to intelligence funds use, let's connect it to Mindanao and Marawi and the Marawi rehab, Senate President.
You know, that was tragic what happened in Marawi, in the Mindanao State University Marawi campus. I am heartbroken, Karen, because, you know, I'm the author of the Bangsamoro Organic Law.
Yeah.
So for the last 6 years, we've had relative peace after passing that Bangsamoro Organic Law. We got former fighters, former leaders, former separatists who wanted to split from Mindanao to become partners in development of their own region, coming up with their own Bangsamoro parliament, coming up with their own little constitution within the Bangsamoro Organic Law. And everything was smooth sailing until the bombing in Marawi last week. Let's face the facts first. Number one, we really can't stamp out extremism. There's going to be extremists everywhere in the world. We were lucky because in the Marawi siege, we pretty much wiped out all the jihadists and the extremists in that one military encounter with them. And because of that, those who believe in separating, that move towards normalization of ties with Philippine government, like the MILF, have become our partners now. But let's face it, ang sabi nga ng military sa amin, itong mga bagong bombers, bagong terrorists, yun yung mga kamag-anak na namatay Samarao.
Maote.
Oh. Yes, the Maote group. So yeah. Dati, batang-bata pa sila. They were 12 years old. Now they're 16, 18, 19 years old. They've still been not convinced of going mainstream and decide to fight everyone else. Because, you know, the Maote group does not recognize even the Bangsamoro government, which is all made up of former fighters and rebel leaders. So that is the problem. It's the Jemaah Islamiyah approach, which is the ISIS. They don't recognize any government. But on the failure of intelligence, Karen, let me put tell you this. We had an executive session. I cannot reveal every particular secret that was mentioned. But I would like to say that as early as October, alam na po nila na magkakaroon ng bombing sa general.
Okay, bakit natuloy, sir? Ba't natuloy, Senate President daw?
Okay. And I don't know if I'd be able to say this, but the problem, according to our armed services, is that they have no control of the Mindanao State University campus.
Okay.
It is the charter similar to the University of the Philippines. They are not allowed to do patrols within the University of Mindanao campus. So, sabi nila, anong magagawa namin? After the bombing, they were able to react immediately. They were there 3 minutes after the bombing with a light reaction unit from the AFP, but outside of the MSU.
But if they really had intelligence, October pa, intelligence funds would have been used to actually source information. Who's behind making the IED?
Alam na po nila, Karen. Alam na po nila.
Why not?
Kasi they had a training. Those training for IED making. And they were trained.
Why not be preventive? Why not be preventive? You know, arrest them, question them, call them, even with just the information on hand.
In fairness to them, Karen, a week prior to the bombing, they had captured or killed about 20 Maote militants in Maguindanao, crossing towards Lanao Sur. And they showed the videos. It was also shown in the ABS-CBN news outlets. And so they're looking at the revenge angle on this Marawi bombing. Kasi naubos yung leadership nila dun sa raid na yun. And speaking to General Broner, they're looking at the angle that it could be revenge with this Marawi incident. And my appeal is to all state universities and colleges in Mindanao, I know you have your own charter, you want to have your own police security system set up, but work with the authorities, work with the armed services, work with the intelligence services. The army has their own intelligence services, and they can tell you the risk factor in your territory, particularly in this areas in BARM. So, ang nangyari, hindi sila ma-deploy, they couldn't put intelligence officials within the MSU. The MSU complex, Karen, is a huge complex. It's huge. It's bigger than UP Los Baños in Marawi. It's thousands of hectares. So, I think what happened there was not only a failure of intelligence, I don't think it's a failure of intelligence, it's a failure of coordination. It's a failure of coordination.
All right, two more questions. I hope you can answer this quickly. Is the Marawi Rehabilitation, Senate President. So I went to Marawi last year. So the government spent billions on building. I do hope that you can bring your colleagues to Marawi one of these days. I even said the speaker should visit it. There are auditoriums, coliseums, gigantic buildings with nobody in them. Because all the residents, their homes are still riddled with bullets. They don't have the money to rebuild their homes. They still live after 6 years in temporary shelters, container vans, outside of Marawi. Pero ang Marawi mismo, that area, there's a sports coliseum, an auditorium. But what for? So I don't know the solution to that, Senate President, but some have said it makes locals disgruntled.
Well, Karen, I'll tell you, we have passed already the Marawi. We have passed already the Marawi compensation law. Okay. Ang kulang kasi dito compensation. Kasi winasak natin yung mga bahay nila. Yeah. So we passed already. I was the author, principal author, together with Senator Bato de la Rosa and several other senators. on the Marawi compensation law. That is now a law. Under the law, these people should be paid. So we're giving, I think last year there was a budget of about 1.5p. This year there's another budget of, I think we increased the budget for the Marawi Compensation Fund. And we're now slowly paying off the victims of their, under the destruction of their homes. So unfortunately, they're not rebuilding. They're getting the money, buying elsewhere.
Yes, exactly.
So they're not really, elsewhere. So, pero wala tayong magagawa, Karen, kasi that is their individual right to do so. Ang akin lang dyan is, it frustrates me because we created the political, we were able to pass the political solution to the age-old problem of injustice being required or requested or demanded by our brother Muslims. What had happened in Marawi, and I must state this for a fact, what had happened to Marawi is not representative of the Muslim faith. I have many peace-loving, yes, I mean 99% peace-loving people. They don't want any incidences like this because they're going to say, eh na naman, magagalit na naman sa atin yung mga Kristiyano. And that's why I appealed in my speech in the Senate, and I said this in my speech, I appeal to the people not to project our brother Muslims in a bad light. This is not representative of the religion. They want peace. They want unity between our peoples. As a matter of fact, those who protested after the bombing were not only Christians, but also kapatid natin na Muslim, no? In Marawi City. So what's important is we have the political setup done, which is the giving them more autonomy, giving them their block grant, being able to allow them to govern on their own with their beliefs and principles. So that's why we appeal to the Baham government to support the effort of government, of national government, to rid ourselves of extremists, because it's not going to be good for them as well. So I think it's a multitude of things for this not to happen again. We've had the briefings with the military and the DND, and they are moving forward to coming up with more security measures for the area, more checkpoints. And of course, they've already have persons of interest. They captured one that they, when they presented to us, apat yun eh. Two were the actual perpetrators, two were lookout and lookout for this incident. Okay. And so we're already on board in catching all four.
Okay. All right. Well, I had another suggestion with housing in Marawi, but we don't have enough time. But the last question is this. Should President Marcos Jr. rejoin the ICC? And do you believe that if he decides to rejoin, does it need Senate concurrence? This is a bit tricky because you had a stand in the past regarding the ICC. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, there's two trains of thought on this issue, Karen. One that they need Senate concurrence. The other one, they don't need Senate concurrence. I remember in your show, Senator Frank Dulon came out and saying, I was watching and listening intently where he said that they don't need Senate concurrence because we did not abrogate in the first place. We did not vote to get out of the ICC. That's the Senator Dulon stand. No? So on that issue, that's a legal issue, Karen. I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not, I'm not going to try to sound like a lawyer here. On the president's stand, I do not know his position on that matter. I would not want to short guess his position on that matter, although he said that they're studying it. But at the same breath, he also said that it's best that we utilize our own courts to decide on certain issues. So I don't want to make a calculated guess in any way on what the president will decide on that matter.
But would you be against it if the president decided?
Well, you know, Karen, we have our laws. We have our laws. We have our courts. If there are certain cases, for example, EG case, the extrajudicial killings, we can file it in our courts here. Why don't we try filing it also in our courts? Filing it in the ICC? Why don't you try filing it in our courts now? And the courts may decide more independently, you know, Karen. So why don't we? I've not heard yet anyone file all those cases that they filed in the ICC to a local court.
Well, there are, I think, a few, but it hits really, I think, lower authorities. So I think this would.
But we're a sovereign nation. We've got a functioning justice system. Why don't they try filing it here? And maybe warrants of arrest will come faster than the ICC.
All right. Okay, let's move on. My last that's a statement right there. But the last one, the peace talks. Vice President Sara Duterte said this is like making a pact with the devil. What are your thoughts on the peace talks with communist rebels again?
I said this also in another interview, Karen. You're talking to the guy who pushed for the political solution for peace with our Muslim rebels, with the separatists in Mindanao. So if you're asking me for peace talks with another group of individuals, why not? Let's give peace a chance. Our soldiers are tired of fighting. You know, I come from a province where there's a presence of the New People's Army. Let's ask them to put down the armed struggle and just join mainstream. All my visits in Europe, whether it was a parliamentary visit to Spain, parliamentary visit to Hungary, to different countries, they had a communist political party. And they're part of the mainstream. They get elected, like in other countries, they get elected as members of parliament. They shout and scream in parliament, not in the streets, nor do they carry guns. Maybe we can do that. We can put up a political solution for that. But they have to lay down their arms and give up their armed struggle, Karen. That has to be number one before we can move forward with this peace process.
All right. On that note, well, we really did it. 9 a.m. Sagarant. Thank you so much. That was a great discussion. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Karen. Mabuhay po ating bansa. Mabuhay po. Good morning, everyone.